welcome to Wine Library TV. I am your host, Gary Bay, Nerchuk. And this, my friends, is the Thunder Show, aka the internet's most passionate wine program. And we clearly have, I feel like I'm on the set of Mr. Wizard. We have a lot going on here. We have a very lovely guest, and we have a very, very intense and interesting show. So Jennifer, why don't you tell the Vayner Nation who you are, tell them about your credentials, don't be shy, and let's talk about what we're gonna do today.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much for having me on. I really appreciate it. My name is Jennifer Simonetti Bryan. It's quite long, but if you can say spaghetti, you can say Simonetti. So it's Jennifer Simonetti Bryan.
You're speaking to a fan base that has had to deal with a guy named
Vaynerchuk. Okay, so you guys
don't
are
worry.
Okay, good. My name's Jennifer Simonetti Bryan, and I am a master of wine. I am the last master of wine to pass in terms of an American. So, and I'm also the fourth woman in the country to ever obtain the title. So to give you some idea, there's only 26 of us in the United States right now. So,
and how many in the world?
How many in the world? There's 270 something, but I think some of us are dying off now. So, you know,
it's like Jedi.
Yeah, you know? I love that. I'm a huge Star Wars fan, so to be a wine Jedi, I just love that. Yeah, it's huge. So, it took me
about... It's a pretty big deal, Jennifer.
Yeah, thank you.
It's not minor leagues by any stretch.
No, thanks. It took me 6 years to prepare for it, and it is a four-day exam.
Clearly showing why I could never be a master of wine. 6 years of anything scares the crap out of me.
No, it's 4 days, and you're tested on viticulture, vinification, the business aspects, and social issues. So a typical essay would be something to the effect of, the world isn't doing enough to address alcoholism. Discuss. So you would have to write, in less than 45 minutes, a 1,000-word, you know, essay on, you know, all the global aspects of alcoholism.
Another reason I couldn't pass the test, because I couldn't write an essay in sixth grade, let alone now.
No, you have to learn. I really had to learn how to write essays, because, you know, it's
a big part of the test.
It's huge. And for the tasting exam, it's 36 wines. You have to identify blind. So as opposed to the Master Sommelier exam, which is done in more of a restaurant setting, mm-hmm. they identify 6 wines. Masters of wine have to identify 36 wines. So I had a friend of mine who joked around with me saying, it's like Master Sommelier squared. But
it's pretty intense.
It's pretty, pretty intense. So it's not for the faint of heart, but we're generally very geeky. You know, a lot of us are very, very geeky, very nerdy. We're a lot of bookworms, but, you know, nerds need love too. We need love.
No doubt.
Yeah. So,
what made you want to go down that path?
Well, I love science. I've always loved science, and I've always...
So you're a science chick.
Yeah, I'm a science chick. Yeah, mm-hmm. I mean, Star Wars, Star Trek, mm-hmm. I'm, you know, very, very geeky. I was one of those nerds in the school. I've always loved science, and I fell in love with wine when I was working in investment banking over in London. And when I was there, it was one lunch that changed my life. And they served an herb-crusted salmon. Mm-hmm. And a Sancerre. Now, it wasn't that the Sancerre was completely amazing. It was just that...
The pairing worked.
It was just... The salmon is a fatty fish,
sure.
So it coated the tongue with an oil. And then the Sancerre being so high acid, it just cleansed the palate. And I thought, oh my God, the chef in the back didn't go, you know, just throw them the Sancerre. They're not going to know the difference anyway. There was a conscious decision to put these two things together.
And at that point, you were somewhat into wine?
No, I had never...
Zero.
Zero. I
double zero.
Double zero. I had, you know,
or
nothing.
Paris.
I mean, even though my family's Italian, we never drank wine. So, and actually, they thought I was absolutely insane when I left the banking industry, left a six-figure salary to go work for a wine store in Greenwich Village. And so they thought I completely lost my mind. And now that I've passed the MW, the biggest change I can say that's happened is that they think this is not a fad anymore. They think that I'm actually going to stick through
stick to
with
it.
Yeah, yeah.
How long from that moment, when was this moment in London?
That moment was 10 years ago.
And that's been it. You've been pretty much
focused. I needed to know everything yesterday. I became absolutely insatiable, which I'm sure your readers can attest to because from what I hear, there, you know, a lot of them are very vociferous and as well as just total geeks about wine, which I love. Which I love that.
What happened after? When did you pass the MW?
In 2008.
And what did you do career-wise after that?
After that, I still work for Rémy Cointreau USA.
And you have since?
I have since. Yeah.
Since when?
I worked with them from 2005.
Got
2005.
And what's your official title with them?
My official title is Master of Wine and Spirits Expert. Everyone should have a title like that.
That sounds pretty badass.
Yeah, pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, I like that. I'm going to be Master of the Universe. Where's my He-Man figures? You keep talking. So, Let me just.
Oh, you've got Thundercats down there. I see that.
I know. I noticed you noticed that. Thank you, Mott. I'm going to be the master of the universe.
Oh, there you go. He-Man.
So, fine. So, what does that entail in your universe?
Meaning what?
What's day-to-day like? Are you training?
Oh, that's exactly what I do. I go around I have the best job on the planet. I go around the country and I train distributor salespeople, sommeliers, consumers. I go around training people on wine. Mm-hmm. So far I've trained thousands of people in the industry. And tomorrow I actually leave for Portland, Oregon, to mm-hmm. do some distributor trainings out there, as well as some in Seattle.
Very cool.
Yeah.
Okay, so what have you set up here?
Okay.
Because
What I wanted to do with you was something a little different, not just come in and taste just champagne.
Right.
I wanted to do a Mythbusters kind of segment with you. So
you do love science.
I do. Yeah, gotta love that show. So we have champagne here, and what we wanted to do is show you the whole concept of decanting champagne.
Which is obviously massively, decanting in general, though it has momentum,
yeah.
is still undervalued.
It's hugely debatable on whether or not you need to do that. I mean, for the longest time, people thought, okay, you're going to open it up, you're going to let it breathe. It's just sit out there right like that. It does nothing because the amount of oxygen that's getting through here...
It's so small,
the surface area. So in general, for wines, people go, do you need it, do you not need it? But for champagne, it's even more controversial.
It's massively.
Yeah, like, absolutely.
To the point where I've been in environments where fisticuffs have been brought out over this... subject matter, it's pretty intense.
Yeah.
Like, especially when you get into the nerdum.
Yeah.
Not as nerd as you, but like us less nerd people that mm-hmm. are not as qualified, it gets really, really emotional.
It does.
Yeah. I'm very big on decanting bubbles and have been for a long time.
Oh, thank you. That's great.
I don't use the right decanter like you brought here.
Yeah, the this particular
decanter.
So does
that make me half nerd?
It might.
Okay.
But this particular type of decanter was created just for champagne in general, because what it does, it decreases the amount of surface area that's seeing the level of oxygen. And also you see here as well is you don't have a lot of areas where it's going, when you're pouring it, it comes out this neck, so you don't have a lot of air circulating with it there as
sure.
well. So it's the decanter that gives you the most opportunity to retain bubbles. So that's what they want here.
Hence why my bubbles have disappeared when I decant.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
And if you, you know, do this. You
and
know,
I love doing that
love
too.
Love doing that.
Now,
you're gonna get them out.
What do you feel about that? I mean, you know, obviously you've had the chance, I know for sure, mm-hmm. to drink older champagnes, mm-hmm. much older champagnes, a lot of which do lose bubbles in a big way.
Mm-hmm.
Are you down on that? Do you think that's a problem?
No. In certain senses, if you pour champagne right out of the bottle, and sometimes I get too excited and you pour it and I stick my nose in the glass
and the bubbles hit you.
The carbon dioxide goes right up to my brain. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you need to wait a little bit because it's just too frothy.
Yeah.
So actually I like it when you have the bubbles have dialed back a notch to actually let it reveal itself a little bit
mm-hmm.
more. And that's, you know, a couple of the reasons why you decant, obviously, for aeration and for clarification, and people don't realize is back in Marie Antoinette's day, they used to decant champagne all the time because it was back then they didn't have the disgorgement as you see now. That was about 100 years later.
I think that back then is by far the most fascinating thing about our industry.
Mm.
When I look at a 1940s catalog from London auction houses, and Chinons go for more than first growth Bordeaux's.
Right.
You start really understanding how much marketing and trends and brands, mm-hmm. you know, have impacted,
mm-hmm.
you know, our industry.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I look.
Imagine tweeting back then.
No, I can't imagine tweeting now, but I do it. No, but I mean, it's really fascinating.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you look at the modern wine tactics and brands,
mm-hmm.
and you take them back even 50 or 100 years ago, it's shot. I mean. Shutting up the pop was a non-factor in this country
mm-hmm.
in demand as early as 1975. Just mm-hmm. non-existent. People didn't want them.
Mm-hmm.
So when I think about that stuff, it really is fascinating.
Mm-hmm. And things comes in ebbs and flows and trends
no question.
And fashions. Yeah. So what we've done here is I've brought one that's nothing's been done to it. And then in order to reduce the bottle variation, what we've done is we have a control wine with the decanter. So half
so
of this...
So break down control, what you mean by that verb.
For in the scientific method, when you do something, you want to make sure that you have something that nothing's been done to so that you can compare it to. So that's why we have something that just to taste it on its own.
Yep.
But because there is bottle variation in everything, and we want to reduce that amount of bottle variation, we've taken a decanter and said, okay, we're going to decant this for about a half an hour, right? So we took it from this bottle, but we kept this closed so that this could be the control for this.
Yeah, it's perfect.
And so we did the same thing again for an hour-long decanting, just to see how the perception of this wine changes after it's been decanted for a half an hour, and if at all any changes have been happened
sure.
after an hour. And some people will say that, you know, after an hour it loses all of its bubbles, why would you do it? Well, for something like the Blanc de Millénaire, this is a Blanc de Blanc.
Yep.
And it's got four Premier Crus.
95 vintage.
Yep.
What's the suggested retail? The Charles Heitzig is what we're using right now.
115.
Okay.
Ish.
Means
yeah.
we probably
I'm sorry, not 115, I'm 150. 150, yeah. something
Which
like.
Probably means we sell for 80, so that's a whole other story for another day, but go ahead.
Yeah, so it's four Grand Crus and one Premier Cru. So you've got, for all the champagne geeks out there, you've got Ménil sur Auger, you've got Auger, you've got Crémant, you have Avize, as well as Vertus. And Vertus is the Premier Cru.
You guys are getting a real treat here, because you know that's how I pronounce them with my Jersey swag. Okay, and so I've had this wine in multiple vintages.
Yes.
Obviously, the 90 was redonkulous. And
actually, it was funny because I saw this segment where you had this particular one last, where you said it was going what you call the Casper syndrome, that
yes.
kind of phase. And I was thinking about that. I was like, that's perfect, because everything that's going on inside a bottle, a lot of people don't realize all the chemical reactions that are happening inside
the bottle.
And I'm
sure you do realize that.
I do, actually. I've always found it fascinating.
And, clearly.
Clearly. And really what's going on is you've got these flavor precursors, which are aldehydes and ketones and things of that sort, that are coming together and pulling apart, let's say, with something like sulfur dioxide.
Sure.
Sulfur dioxide, when it combines with an aldehyde, mutes it. So all of a sudden, it becomes quiet. And I think in 2007, when you had tasted this, it was probably going through its dumb phase.
Which a lot of people have heard, and that's really what you see in a lot of products. And what's really ironic, help us out here, mm-hmm. a lot of times wines, when they first come out the gate, you can taste in that first year, and then it hits
that's right.
its dumb phase.
Yeah.
And we, you know, I've seen that a lot with a lot of 90. The real vintage that's really been great for my palate, mm-hmm. and what really got me to nerd it up more and more, and has really taught me a lot, has been the 95 Bordeaux vintage. I did something really smart mm-hmm. For myself, to educate myself. I took about 9 producers, and I've been drinking them every year.
That's a good idea.
For yeah. the last, geez, almost like 10 years now, mm-hmm. out of that case, De Cru Bocayou, you know, and Fuzel, and Brenier, and just some different producers, and it's been magnificent to mm-hmm. learn the process, to watch, so Smith Hall Lafitte, mm-hmm. 95, the first two vintages were so big, mm-hmm. intense, got all that fruit, got all that, you know, dirtiness and terroir that is so great from the Grab. Mm-hmm. For 4 or 5 years in a row, every bottle, different bottle variation, mm-hmm. I get that too, but just tight as a rock.
Yeah.
And then clearly, over the last 3 or 4 bottles, I've just watched it
yeah.
open up to the last bottle was more open than even the first two vintages.
Yeah.
But it was like first and second, and now 8 and 9. Were the most open. Mm-hmm. So I think that's really, the dummy phase is really fascinating to me.
Well, there's a lot of, like I said, there's a lot of chemical reactions that are happening inside of the bottle, and you don't know what phase you're attacking it in. So when you open it up, you don't know what to expect, which is the reason why wine is so beautiful. And when you have that one wine that you see year after year and how it's developed, it's amazing.
Let me just jump in here real quick. If you really want to get there, and so many of you do, I would highly recommend finding an interesting wine that can last over a 12 to 15 year period and going through this process. Maybe you can do it on your birthday or an anniversary. Would be really cool to, you know, buy a case of a vintage from your anniversary. Something that you can consistently, no joke, on the same day, drink the same wine. It is really one of the most fascinating, you know, I got to nerd it up. You're bringing out the nerd in me.
Yeah,
I don't talk about, usually
no.
talk about the Jets and
for
this
champagne,
and that.
For champagne, what you want to do, you definitely want something that has a high level of acidity, and choosing something that, let's say, is a Blanc de Blanc is going to have the highest level
do
of acidity.
Do you think the O2 vintage, given what
yes.
it's, right?
Yeah,
I would
the
say
O2
right,
vintage probably
they're available,
be, yeah.
it's got the acid
yeah.
as a vintage.
It depends on what the producer is.
Always.
And it depends on how long it's been aged for.
I mean, I can make bad wine in every vintage. Definitely. Money in the bank.
So it depends on how long it's been laying on its lease as well.
Okay, sure.
So, I mean, this one's been on its lease for at least a decade. So the longer that you have it on lease, the longer that it's going to last, because as it's laying down.
Remember the apple cider thing from the other day?
Go ahead. Okay.
Go
That's okay. Because when it's laying down on its lees, you have a process called autolysis that's happening. So you've got these yeast cells that are in there that break open and have all these acetyl compounds and nitrogenous compounds that are being released into the wine. And that gives you the
toasty. You're loving this, huh?
Judging it too early today.
Mott's like trying to take notes. He's like, his head's exploding.
The toasty, biscuity aromas, that's what you get from that. But at the same time, what's going on is all that carbon dioxide that was created from that second fermentation is creating those bubbles, but the longer that it's laying down, they get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller, and it gets more dissolved into the liquid. So the longer the bubbles are going to last once you disgorge it.
So before I fail another science class in my life, I think we should taste the first wine.
Absolutely. Okay. Here we go. This is the control. We wanted to taste it by itself. Nothing's been done to it.
Okay.
And this is fairly warm, but I think... Thank you very much.
Talk to me about room temperature champagne.
It's fairly nasty, actually.
Are you massively against it?
If I have my druthers, I would.
The only wine that I don't drink at room temperature, because I drink almost all my white wine at room temperature.
Well, what you can do, you do find that anything at room temperature is going to reveal
so much more.
Yeah, it's going to reveal so much more, but that acid is going
to
be.
And alcohol a lot of times, right?
And alcohol,
especially
but
in white
wines. But the acidity in the wine is going to be just so harsh.
But I like that.
Well,
like
if you're an acid freak, that, you know.
You know, I legitimately want the wine to hurt me. It's why I love Captain Crunch.
Oh,
you know, if you eat enough Captain Crunch, it will tear the top
of the roof
of your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
I like that.
It's the amount of sugar in it as well.
Yeah, so that's also very good. All right, so let's get in here. We should probably snippy-snip this up.
Uh-huh. Technical term, snippy-snip.
Yes, that's my technical term. You know what's funny? I got a quick blast there of almost like a marzipan kind of thing.
I get lots of toasty, biscuity kind of aromas. And some dried fruit.
Yeah, you know, this is where cereal, maybe the innuendo, but this does have like that Cinnamon Toast Crunch kind of thing going on.
I love cereal. You're talking my language.
Having Masters of Wine spin into Jets buckets is an enormous thrill for me. It just makes me very happy on so many different layers
and levels. I have to actually apologize to I have an identical twin, and I have to apologize.
You do?
I do. I have to apologize to her because she's the biggest Giants fan out there. So I have to apologize, Elizabeth. I'm so sorry to see me touching anything Jets, but...
I just wish the entire Vayner Nation could just see the smile on Mott's face, a diehard Giants fan. So the golden apple component is really dominating my palate.
Mm.
There's a lot of cut fresh apples.
There is. But what I also taste here as well, in a vis, you get a lot of lead pencil from the terroir. And there is like a string of that minerality, that kind of lead pencil that's in there.
To me, it's almost even chalky.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's almost even chalky.
And you're going to get that
almost
from
like
the Côte
chalk
de Blanc.
Dust.
Yeah.
You're going to get
the Côte de Blanc, that's exactly what you're going to get from the Côte de Blanc. That is the terroir notes coming through that you're getting there. Yeah. So, but the bubbles are very tiny. If you take the champagne
God,
in your mouth.
Bubbles.
Yeah. You take the champagne in your mouth, and for those out there who don't taste champagne all the time, press your tongue up against your palate and really feel the size of those bubbles. Because the smaller the bubbles, the finer the mousse. The finer the mousse, the more delicate the texture, which is the higher the quality of the champagne. And because this has been, you know, laying on lees for, you know,
12?
Yeah.
Is it 12?
Over a decade.
Yeah.
They're very, very tiny.
Now the acidity on the back end of the palate is noticeable, but not kind of overbearing in any shape or form.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like they really integrate well and kind of smooth out.
Mm.
And then you really start tasting that creamy texture of like a creaminess.
I love this
like
wine.
Like a creme. You know?
Mm. What I really like about this wine is that it's very tight in the beginning. And that's why one of the reasons why I've chosen this wine in order to do the decanting. Well, Charles Heidsieck itself has come out with packaging with a decanter this holiday
season. Is that right?
Yeah, it has. But the reason
is... It's a
nice
little plug for Big Brother there. That's good work.
That's good. No, but the thing is that the reason why they chose it is because it is very, very tight.
So is this the decanter it comes with?
Yeah, that is the decanter.
And how much is the upcharge? Is there?
I don't think it's new.
$6?
$6?
$60.
$600
for the whole thing?
$600. I was trying, guys. I was really, really trying. Okay. So I've got this mentally down. Okay. I'm ready to move on.
Okay, we're ready to move on.